Hi, Pastor Steve here. I want to thank you for listening today, and I want to encourage you because I know that God will truly bless you as you study His Word. So hey, let's get started.
Good morning, Lawrence Heights Christian Church. Good morning, Lawrence Heights Christian Church. There we go. Welcome to the Heights. We're glad to have you here this morning. If you'll stand to your feet, we're going to begin by singing some songs of praise together this morning. It's a beautiful day to worship the Lord. Amen. Coming on the clouds.
He's coming on the clouds. Kings and kingdoms will bow down. And every chain will break. His broken hearts declare His praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the light. The Lion of Judah, He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. Oh, so open up the gates. So open up the gates. Make way before the King of Kings. The God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power, fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. Our God is sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Stop the Lord Almighty. Sing it again. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord?
Sing it out.
Our God is the Lion of Judah.
Church, we're going to continue to sing together as we sing of the Lord's great faithfulness, His promises that never fail. Sing together. God of Abraham.
God of Abraham, You're the God of covenant, faithful promises. Time and time again. just what you say. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast. And in my heart, when you speak a word, it will come to pass. Great is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting, same, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me. May pass away, your word remains the same. Yeah, your history can prove there's nothing you can't do. Faithful and true, though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast. And in my heart, learn when you speak a word, it will come.
Seated for a moment of communion.
I have failed God many times, but God has never failed me. My name is Ben, and I'm the associate pastor here at the Heights. And this morning, around our country and around the world, Christians will remember the sacrifice of Jesus through communion. And all of us are united by failure. All of us are sinners. Each one of us comes to the Lord's table marred by our sin and our own mistakes. And although all of us are united by failure, more importantly, we're united by the grace of God. We've all failed God, but he has never failed us. Jesus Christ offers us the free gift of salvation to all who will receive him. 2 Timothy 2:13 says, if we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot disown himself. At communion each week, we remember the faithfulness of Jesus. We remember the faithfulness of our Lord that led him to the cross. We remember his body, we remember his blood, and we stand in awe that he went to the cross for our sins. The Lord's Supper is a reminder of the grace of God to each and every one of us. Here at the Heights, we practice open communion. And what that means is that we invite all followers of Jesus to participate with us. The communion servers will bring the elements to you, and there will be two cups. There will be one containing the juice that's representing Jesus' blood, and one containing the bread representing his body. Take the elements when you're ready after a time of prayerful reflection, remembering Jesus' sacrifice and examining your life in light of that sacrifice. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for sending your son Jesus to die on the cross for our sins. We're thankful for the opportunity that we have to take time and remember you each week in communion. We praise you, God, that although we've failed you many times, you have never failed us. We take this time to examine ourselves and to remember your sacrifice for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Church, whenever you're ready, please stand as we continue to sing together.
Yeah.
the song is an amazing opportunity for us to do just that, to give God all the praise and all the glory. So let's sing this together. Holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty.
What a powerful time of worship. Will you please join me in showing our appreciation for our praise team leading us in worship today? Amen. Amen. And once again, good morning to you, church.
Good morning.
Welcome, welcome, welcome. We are so glad that you're here today. For those of you who are following along online, we're so glad that you're staying connected as well. If you happen to be new around here, maybe even checking us out for the very first time, my name is Steve. I'm one of the pastors here. And not only do I want to welcome you, but I want to invite you to make this your church home. This really is a place where you can belong and use your talents to glorify Christ. Our mission here, which is taken directly from the Great Commission, is to follow Jesus, love people, so that we can reach the world. Making disciples and equipping the saints for radical service is what we're all about, and we're inviting you to join us on that mission. Specifically, we believe God has given us a vision to reach even just 1% of our community for Jesus Christ. But in order for that to happen, we need you. We need every single one of you doing your part for God's glory. And the easiest way for you to get started can be found there inside your bulletin. Hopefully you grabbed one of these on your way in. Please find that little tear-off connections card there on the side. We'd love for you to take a moment, fill out a little bit of information. Let us know that you were here, how we can be a blessing and an encouragement to you, and how you'd like to connect and get involved today. Then for your convenience, you can just tear it right out and leave it in the offering box back in the back on your way out. Now, if you've been with us in recent weeks and you know that we're in the middle of a series studying the book of Philippians, verse by verse, chapter by chapter. So if you haven't done so already, go ahead and grab your Bible nearby or your Bible app on your mobile device. We're ready to begin chapter 4 today, Philippians chapter 4. Once you find that spot, I'll encourage you to also mark your place in 2 Timothy chapter 2. So Philippians 4, 2 Timothy chapter 2. As you're making your way there to those starting spots, let me just remind you that spring is right around the corner. In fact, don't forget to set your clocks forward next weekend. Otherwise, we will tease you when you show up late to church. We will tease you lovingly, of course, because this is a safe place of grace. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Also there in your bulletin, please note all the Bible studies that are available to you. Men, I want to point out the fact that there's a brand new Bible study for you that's offered at two different times, beginning tomorrow, Monday evening at 6:30, and also then Tuesday morning at 6 a.m. So there's an evening and a morning opportunity. It's the same study. Join us as we begin walking through the epistles of John, starting with 1 John together this week. Also there in your bulletin, you've
Hopefully you found a postcard that looks like this. This is for you, but it's not for you to keep. This is for you to give away and invite somebody to church with you at Easter weekend. We've got Good Friday service, Resurrection Sunday, our two services here, celebration services on Sunday morning. But you should have somebody with you. So be sure if you need extra, there's plenty of them out in the foyer. Grab these, invite your family, your friends, your coworkers, your neighbors. We'd love to have them join us as we celebrate the resurrection. And with that, what do you say we go to the Lord in prayer, and together let's just set our hearts and our minds on his goodness, and together let's ask him to speak to us through his word today to shape and mold us as his church. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this moment in time. We are alive. There's breath in our lungs. That means that there's hope for whatever's going on in our lives right now, that you can make it new. And you could do far above and beyond anything that we ask, think, or imagine. So, Lord, as we open up your word today and read a 2,000-year-old letter that was inspired by your Holy Spirit, Lord, we pray and ask that you would speak a fresh word to us today. And give us courage, Lord. And give us comfort. Please draw our hearts together with you and with each other in a way that only you can. We pray this together as a church family in Jesus' name. And all together in unity, the church said, amen. 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 So how many of you know that life happens, right? You never know what a day is going to bring. The Apostle Paul knows this because he's writing this letter from prison. Remember, he actually thought he was going to be going to Rome as a preacher, but instead he went to Rome as a prisoner. Life has setbacks. It has disappointments. There's conflict. People will let you down, and you will let yourself down. And then there are times where you can't control what you think in your head, and sometimes it feels like you can't even control what you do. So there's this battle. There's this fight in life to try to stay the course and to do what's right. And Paul says we're actually to fight this fight God's way, as citizens of heaven. In our time together today, we're going to see Paul getting very practical about giving people ways to fight, but in a different kind of way, in the way that God would have us to fight. Because again, remember, we are citizens of a different place. As we begin again in Philippians chapter 4, verse 1, Paul starts out by using that word again. Do you see it there? It's that word therefore. Remember, whenever we see that word, we always stop and ask, what is that therefore, right? Well, it's there because Paul's pointing back to something he just said in chapter 3. Remember, he said, because we are Christians, he says, we are citizens of heaven. And as Christians, we have the promise of resurrection, that Jesus is coming back and he's going to transform our bodies to be like his glorious body. And as Christians, we're all going to be in heaven together one day. And because that those things are true and nobody can take them away from us, Paul is now going to say this, Philippians chapter 4, verse 1, therefore, my brothers, you whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, that is how you should stand firm in the Lord, dear friends. And I plead with Euodia, and I plead with Syntyche to agree with each other in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you, loyal yoke fellow, help these women who have contended at my side in the cause of the gospel, along with Clement and the rest of my fellow workers whose names are in the book of life. So here, Paul is now addressing two women in the church who are in public conflict. I mean, can you imagine that moment? You've come to church just like this on a Sunday morning. You're listening to this letter being read by the messenger Epaphroditus when all of a sudden you hear your name in Paul's letter. He's calling these two women out. These two women helped found and lead the church. They were co-laborers who helped Paul. But their names are being called out now because their conflict has become so public that Paul has now heard about it hundreds of miles away in jail. So can you imagine the embarrassment of being called out like that? I don't know if you've ever been in a conflict before, but sometimes it can feel just so big and so heavy that it actually drowns out your calling and your purpose in life. It can even paralyze you.
So Paul is addressing a very uncomfortable thing here, but he knows that it's actually better to have an awkward moment where we confront something so that we can deal with it than it is to have this private, quiet, bitter, unforgiving spirit that just erodes your soul and even the whole church. So the first way that Paul is going to encourage the Philippians to fight is this, and you note takers, you could write it down this way. Point number one there in your notes, fight conflict with forgiveness. You see, unity is worth fighting for. And Paul is going to fight for it in this letter that he's writing. And here's what we know about forgiveness. Forgiveness does not come naturally, but it does come supernaturally. It comes when you invite God to speak and to help you work through the process. So stop and think. How does conflict start? Well, sometimes it starts with a misunderstanding. Maybe it's the person that you live with, or the person that you work with, or the person that you're friends with. There's an unmet expectation or misunderstanding, and then there's a little bit of hurt and a little bit of anger and frustration, and before you know it, their wall goes up and your wall goes up, and they keep going up higher and higher until pretty soon you can't even explain why it's so hard to even be in the same room with that person. You can't explain how it happened in the first place, or certainly how it can be fixed. You just feel stuck. So our time together this morning, we're going to look at some biblical principles, because in life, as Christians, you can either choose to hold on to grudges and resentment, or you can take all the energy God has given you and choose to fight for unity and peace and forgiveness and reconciliation. To the church at Philippi, Paul's saying, guys, I want you to help Clement and help these two women, my faithful companions, to get along. Why? Well, because their witness matters in the world. So in our time together today, we're going to be talking about the practice of forgiveness. Everybody say practice.
Practice.
Forgiveness takes practice. So one of the practices that we have to have if we're going to be Christians who fight conflict with forgiveness is this. We have to practice believing the best in people and believing the best in situations. You see, far too often when somebody says something or when they do something, we tend to question their motives, don't we? And we do so with suspicion. We fill in the blanks with suspicion. Oh, I know why they did that. Or you know what? Here's what they really meant when they said this. Church, listen, we got to be so very careful here. Because what you're really saying is that you can read their mind. And when we do that, we're actually taking the place of God. When we say that we know what they're thinking and why they're doing it, and there's no place for you in somebody else's head, that's God's place. God's the only one who knows what you're thinking and what you're feeling and why you do what you do. So together, let's just let God be God and let us be us, right? Don't fill in the blanks with suspicion. Instead, fill in the blanks with trust. 1 Corinthians 13, Paul said, love believes the best, right? So if we have a choice between filling in the blank in a conflict with suspicion or filling it in with trust, we as Christians are called to fill it in with trust. In fact, listen, if you want to suspect somebody in a conflict, the best person to suspect is actually yourself. Suspect yourself, because the person who's deceived you more than anybody else and hurt you more than anybody else and created more conflict for yourself than anybody else is actually the person that you see in the mirror every single day. Sorry to say it, friend, but it's you. Remember, Jeremiah 17:9 says that your heart and my heart is deceitful above all things, that it's beyond cure. Who can understand it? He asks. Many times we get so caught up in something that we can't see our way out, which is why the Bible is challenging us to practice believing the best. And it's not just believing the best, but how can I grow to the place where I'm just not so easily offended? What would it be like if I was unoffendable? Not sure that's an actual word in the English language, but you know what I'm saying there, right? You see, we live in an offense culture today that says if you don't adjust to me, or if you don't understand or see things my way, if you're not tolerant of me, well, then I'm being judged and victimized. And I can sit over here with all these hurts. I've been offended. And I can actually find other people who've been hurt just like me. And we can create this whole identity around how we've been hurt. And we can just let those feelings fester. Listen carefully, my friend. The more easily offended you are, the more broken relationships you will have in your life. So you've got to decide. Do you want to be so easily offended that all those relationships are blowing up all around you? Or do you want to be somebody who says, God, give me the strength of heart to just not be so easily offended? Paul put it this way in Romans 12:18. He says, if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. If it's possible, if that person will actually have a conversation with you, as far as it depends on you, the question here is, are you willing to do your part? Are you willing to see how you may have contributed to the problem and caused that conflict to escalate? Because if we're honest, most likely there's a plank in your own eye, but you're trying to take the speck out of somebody else's eye. Is there something that you can own there where you can say, you know what, I'm sorry, without qualifying it or adding a but to the apology? Again, if it's possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everybody. But in order to do that, you have to practice giving up your right to be right. And that's probably the hardest part. Because in a conflict, what's easier to say? That the other person's wrong or that you're wrong? I'll confess, it is way easier for you to be wrong than for me to be wrong, right? But to be able to say, you know what, I don't have to be right on this one. In fact, I can be wrong. Being able to do that actually brings one of the walls down and allows something beautiful to happen. That's why Paul's saying to the Philippian church, listen, guys, you are co-laborers in the gospel. You help plant this church as an outpost for the Christian faith in the middle of the Roman Empire. And yet this conflict between these two women in the church is actually eroding the message of the gospel, both to that church as well as to that city. Paul's saying your conflict is actually making Jesus look bad. We need to be very thoughtful about this because Satan is the author of lies and confusion. He breeds division. And he comes to steal, kill, and destroy families, relationships, and even churches. His whole strategy is to create this sense of division. And when we fight and give way to unhealthy conflict, it says something that's just untrue about Jesus Christ. And it leads to giving him a bad name. Church, I cannot underscore or emphasize that point enough. When you attack somebody else in the church, do you know who feels the pain? Jesus does. Jesus feels that pain. In fact, when Paul was speaking to the Corinthians about division in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, he said, don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple? And God's spirit lives in you. If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him, for God's temple is sacred, and you are that temple. Can you guys feel the weight of that? Now, I know preachers love to use that verse all the time to tell people, well, this is why you shouldn't smoke, or this is why you shouldn't drink. God will judge you if you destroy your temple. But you need to understand, that's not what this verse means. This is the plural you, like you all. Or y'all, as they say in the South. Y'all are God's people. If anybody does something to destroy the group of Christians who gather together through division or slander or gossip or lies, listen, there's a judgment coming for you. There's a heavy, heavy weight to that. I mean, think about it this way. If you're a parent here today and your kids are all together, even though each one of them may have their own issues, the one thing that hurts your heart the most, more than anything else, is if they're divided against each other, when they're fighting or bickering, or when they hate, when they hold grudges against each other. And our Heavenly Father is the exact same way. We know the world's gone crazy. We know there's all kinds of chaos. But there's this incredible joy that God has when we dwell together in unity. It's a place where God commands a blessing. And you and me, we need to think about that. These two women have totally lost sight of this idea. So Paul's saying, I want you two women to consider your conflict, whatever it's about, I want you to consider it in light of eternity. He's saying, don't you know that your names are written down in the Lamb's Book of Life in heaven? There's something so powerful about Paul saying, whatever that conflict is about, the weight of it when compared to eternity is nothing at all. Let me just share with you personally that many times it doesn't happen like that. I mean, I will share with you and confess, I remember going through a conflict with another Christian leader. This Christian leader had been a dear friend. We'd gone through so many things together. That because of some challenges in the church, some division occurred. A wall began to go up. And I don't even know to this day if we could describe how it really happened, but I'll tell you, I was left over here feeling hurt, feeling betrayed, feeling lied to, and even stabbed in the back. Now, of course, I knew the right answer was to forgive. I mean, Jesus taught us to pray that way, right? Forgive our debts as we forgive our debtors. So I was obedient. God, I forgive him for all the things that he did, even those things that are still hurting and bothering me right now. And I did. I forgave him. But what I discovered was every time I heard his name, every time I saw him, my hands would start to sweat. My heart would start beating faster. My blood pressure would start going up. What was happening was that my body was telling my soul that I'm actually a liar. That even though I said I'd forgiven him, my body was having this physiological reaction to the pain every time I saw or heard this person. Now, let me ask, what happens when your body tells you that you're a liar? You should really pay attention to that. It means that what's happened up here in your head has not yet made it down here to your heart. Let me just ask, can any of you relate, or is this just group therapy for me? Right? Yeah. Okay. So what do we do with that? Because I know that some of you have had similar struggles. Well, I'll tell you, what's helped me is the understanding that I'm actually going to get to spend eternity in heaven with this guy. He and I are both sinners saved by grace. Neither one of us are going to get into heaven because we're doing all the right things. We're going to be in heaven together because God saved us. Even with all of our flaws, he rescued us. So since we're going to be together in heaven forever, for all of eternity, God says, Steve, you better get over this, man. I'm telling you, once God got it from my head to my heart, it was gone. Gone, gone. Sometime later, something really beautiful happened. He reached out one day and said, see, I want to apologize for the way that I treated you. In fact, I vowed never to treat anybody like that ever again. Now, you need to know that reconciliation like that, that kind of moment for you may never come. Or it could happen maybe 10 years from now. But whatever you do, don't hold a grudge for 10 years waiting for it, because it'll just suffocate the life that God has for you and the life of the people around you. Practice forgiveness. Fight conflict with forgiveness. Then in verse 4, Paul goes on to say this, rejoice in the Lord always. I'll say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all, the Lord is near. What's Paul doing there? He's elevating again. He's saying, guys, there's a conflict, but remember, your names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. So there's always a reason to rejoice. Think it through. The opposite of joy is not sadness, because you could actually rejoice in sadness, because joy is like a buoyancy. It's something that helps you rise above. Don't forget that Paul is writing this letter in chains in a Roman prison. And yet he's still able to say that there's always a reason to rejoice. He's saying that the things on the outside of your life don't have to touch what you have on the inside, the unsinkableness that joy gives you. And then he says, let your gentleness, or maybe your translation, your Bible might say your moderation or your reasonableness, let it be evident to all. So the second very practical big idea that Paul has given the Philippians, point number 2 there in your notes, go ahead and jot it down. He's saying to fight extremism with moderation. We live in a world of extremism, do we not? We live in a world of division and accusation, and it feeds two primary emotions. It feeds fear and it feeds anger. It's actually become a business model these days, because if you can make somebody angry, if you can make them afraid, then they'll click on the next thing, and then the next thing, and then the next thing, and in no time at all, they're in the algorithm, right? Why do I always feel so fearful and angry? Well, it's because it's what you're consuming. And today, moderation seems to be a thing of the past. Yeah, come on now, Steve, how can we be moderate when the whole world's on fire? And there's a war, the economy's going to crash, global warming's creating all these storms. Look what's happening in Washington, D.C., and even right here in our own backyard.
every day there's this sense of panic and outrage. What do fear and anger do? Well, they totally drain your energy to fight the way that God would want you to fight. Listen, if you carry anger in your heart, if you carry fear in your soul, it just drains your spiritual and emotional energy to pray and to serve, to care, and to love, and to advocate, and to fight in the ways that God wants you to fight. But the Lord is near, Paul says, which means regardless of whatever happens in Washington, D.C. or in Lawrence, Kansas, no matter what happens, one thing is still true, that Jesus is still king. Amen? Amen. No matter what. If the economy crashes and famine comes and we're struggling in ways that we've never struggled before, here's what we know for a fact. God is our provider. He's Jehovah Jireh, and he will meet the needs of his people. We know that. And what's amazing is because the Lord is near, because his promise is over his church and his people, we can actually take a great big deep of breath of relief, right? In fact, let's do that right now. Let's practice that. Everybody take a great big deep breath in. Okay, let it out. We can actually breathe easy. But if we're not careful, what happens is the things that we see on the news, the notifications we get on our phone, can actually create that sense of panic. Yeah, Steve, man, I got to tell you, this whole moderation thing doesn't exactly work in a culture that's so hostile to Christianity. I mean, don't you realize the aggressive nature with which the culture is trying to extinguish Christianity? Well, yes, I get it. I really do. But stop and think for a minute. Again, let me remind you, when was this letter written? It was written when Herod, a collaborator of Rome, was sitting on the throne in Jerusalem. Not only that, but he was also sleeping with his brother's wife, and he was so sexually turned on by his brother's wife's daughter that he made a promise and then cut off John the Baptist's head. And if any person rebelled against Rome for any reason, he had them put on crosses with their families lining the city for miles. For miles, as you walked into the city, you would see men, women, and children suffering and dying in excruciating ways simply because they stood against something that Rome said. Let me tell you, there's nothing more hostile than crucifixion. And yet in the middle of that culture, in that day, Paul still says, let your reasonableness and your moderation and your gentleness be known to all. Why? Because the Lord is near. In fact, if you'll turn in your Bible just for a moment to 2 Timothy chapter 2, I want you to see how Paul describes it there. And as you're making your way there, you need to know that this letter, 2 Timothy, is actually his last letter. He knows that he's about to be executed. He knows he's about to be beheaded. So here's how he's going to go out, knowing that he's about to be killed in an unjust way by an unjust government. He's going to speak to his spiritual son, Timothy, about the way we deal with the world around us and how it's pressuring us. Look at what he says in 2 Timothy 2, verse 23. He says, don't have anything to do with foolish and stupid arguments because you know they produce quarrels. And the Lord's servant must not quarrel. Instead, he must be kind to everyone, able to teach, not resentful. Those who oppose him, he must gently instruct in the hope that God will grant them repentance, leading them to a knowledge of the truth, and that they will come to their senses and escape from the trap of the devil who has taken them captive to do his will. Let me just ask, what would happen if every Christian took that seriously? God's servants are not to engage in foolish and stupid arguments, quarrels, and be divisive. Instead, we're to gently instruct those who oppose us in the hope that they too can come to repentance. But the challenge is we get so many messages that make us feel afraid, don't we, and angry. And we think that the whole kindness and moderation and gentleness thing just doesn't work anymore. In fact, I'll tell you, one of the greatest truth tellers is the way that we pray for our leaders. You know, people have actually told me, I don't think we should be praying for this president. Others have told me, I don't think we should be praying for the last president. You know, I'm just going to take a second here and mention four names to you, and probably every one of you in the room are going to be triggered one way or the other. Are you ready? Here we go. Listen. Bush, Obama, Trump, Biden. Can you feel the tenseness in the room all of a sudden? Let me ask, do you know how history is going to remember those four guys? 43, 44, 45, and 46. You see, because God spoke to Nebuchadnezzar, one of the most powerful leaders in the world, and he said, don't you realize that I'm the God who raises leaders up and sets them down for my purposes in the world? At the end of the day, God has always been the one in charge. He raises men and women up for his purposes. And that right there should give us a great sense of peace, right? That fact should enable us to breathe easily. So how does God want us to fight? Well, he wants us to fight with this deep sense of trust that he is, in fact, Jehovah Jireh, and that he's in control of all of human history. But, and this is very important, we also pray. 2 Corinthians 10, Paul says that the weapons that we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, our weapons have divine power to demolish strongholds. Yes, we want to fight, but we don't want to fight the same way that the world does. So we fight extremism with moderation. We fight in a spiritual way. We fight in prayer. 2 Timothy 2, Paul tells us to pray for all of those in authority, kings and leaders at all level. Why? Well, it's because it pleases our Savior. It pleases our Savior when you pray for the president, whether you voted for him or not. It pleases our Savior when you pray for those in Congress or our governor or our police chief or our school board. In Paul's day, that meant that you were praying for Nero, the man who was killing Christians, because it pleases God for citizens of heaven to fight in a different kind of way. And then Paul says, not only should you let your moderation be known to all, your gentleness, your reasonableness to be known to all, because the Lord is near. In verse 6, he says, don't be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. In other words, you can fight anxiety with grateful prayer. In fact, I'm going to ask you to go ahead and write it down that way. Point number 3 there in your notes. Fight anxiety with grateful prayer, which means when you stop to think about it, you don't actually have to be anxious. Worry is the thief of joy. And if you spend your life in this anxiety-driven existence, then you'll never be able to rise above it. So Paul is saying, I'm inviting you, Philippian church, to know that every time that an anxious thought comes, there is a way to fight it. Can't always fight the feelings that come, but we can fight the thoughts that come. And Paul's trying to teach us how to fight here. He says, when anxiety comes, you can fight it with gratitude and with prayer. Let me just tell you a little secret that a lot of people don't know. You can't actually hold anxiety and gratitude in your heart at the same time. It's just impossible. Want to give it a try? Think about something that you're really, really, really anxious about right now. Do you have it? Okay, now think about something that you're really, really, really grateful for. Now let them just try to sit together there in your heart. It doesn't work that way, does it? Because one minute you're thinking, God, what's happening in my family? Or, God, this happened and now I can't pay my bills. Or, God, the whole world's gone crazy. But then when you stop and say, God, I thank you for life, for breath, and for saving me. What happens is that it starts to elevate your heart in a powerful way. And we see then that we can actually replace anxiety with grateful prayer. Our dear brother in Christ, Reuben Odoloren, who's serving as a missionary in his home country of Nigeria, many of you know that he has lost his eyesight to macular degeneration. But you would never know it by talking to him, because when you talk to him, he says, oh, God is so good. He's given me an amazing wife and an amazing life, and whether he heals me this week or calls me home, I'm good because God is good. Deep in his soul, God has weaved in him a gratitude regardless of the circumstances around him. Far too often in our lives, we get worried and we get consumed by all these little things, whereas God has so much more for us. So fight anxiety with grateful prayer. Paul says it'll guard your heart and mind. And again, I want to remind you, think about where Paul is when he's writing this. He's writing this while being chained to two Roman guards. But he's so grateful in prayer that he's like, you know what? These guards are actually guarding me, just like the peace of God guards my heart and mind in Christ Jesus. And then in verse 8, he says, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. In other words, you could write it down this way, point number 4 there in your notes. You can fight toxic thinking with thoughtful meditation. Now, I'll tell you, I get that question all the time. Steve, how do I meditate? Well, let me just put it this way. If you know how to worry, then you know how to meditate, okay? Because worrying is just taking a negative thought and spinning it in your mind over and over and over again, whereas meditating is simply taking a positive thought, the truth of God's word, and spinning it in your mind over and over and over again. And Paul says that if you can take what's right and what's true and what's noble and what's praiseworthy, and if you could let that be the loudest voice in your head, all of a sudden the fear and anxiety about what's going to happen next, like, oh no, what's going to happen if I don't pass that test? Or, oh no, what's going to happen if the result of this doctor's visit doesn't go well? Or what's going to happen if this relationship never gets repaired? What's going to happen if he never comes home or she never comes home? Or what happens if I'm always going to be like this? Paul says we can fight that kind of toxic thinking with thoughtful meditation. Now, I want to challenge you to stop and think about how Jesus modeled this. Remember, in all the busyness and craziness of life, what would he do? He would get away in the morning in order to get alone with his Father. In the frenzy of everybody wanting to meet him, what would he do? Well, he would get down on his knees and play with little children. And when his own disciples denied knowing him, when they totally abandoned him, upon his reunion with them a few days later, what did he do? He cooked them breakfast on a beach. So what would happen if we began to meditate on what was actually true? And that became the loudest voice in our heads. In Luke 6:45, Jesus said, a good man brings good things out of the good stored up in his heart, and the evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in his heart. For out of the overflow of his heart, his mouth speaks. Let me ask, has that ever happened to you? In the heat of the moment, something just comes flying out of your mouth, and you say, you know what? I don't even know where that came from. I know exactly where that came from. It came from inside you. Whatever comes out of your mouth was in there. It just took something to bring it out. Jesus is saying something very powerful here. He's saying that you're constantly storing things up in your heart, either good or bad, and eventually that good or bad is going to come out of your mouth. So as Christians, if our meditation in the Bible is only about 2 or 3 minutes a day, but yet we spend hours and hours on social media or CNN or Fox News, well, then we shouldn't be surprised or confused about why we're so stressed or anxious or angry or cynical or critical or proud or self-centered, right? Again, whatever is true, whatever is right, whatever is noble, whatever is praiseworthy, Paul says, meditate on those things. And the peace of God is going to guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus, and some beautiful things are going to happen. So seriously, stop and think. What have you filled your mind with this past week? Yeah, Steve, I probably shouldn't have watched that show because, you know, when I did, it made me think of all these things and it just took me off track. Or the music that I listened to made me feel a certain way. We've got to be so thoughtful about that. And what if we were people of truth? What if we only posted things on social media that are good and noble and praiseworthy? And what if we were more thoughtful about the words that we use and how they may affect other people? How would the world see us then? How can we be people of honor? Remember, Paul says, whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel. Even if people slander you, 1 Peter 3:16, that they'd actually feel ashamed of their slander because of the way that you've lived your life. What would it be like if we were people of justice? Job said that he put on his robe and his turban of righteousness every single day when he got dressed. That was just his way of saying, this is the way that I want to be in the world. So how do we extend mercy and compassion to others? How can we be people of holiness? Now, I realize that holiness isn't exactly in vogue these days. It's kind of gone out of fashion. I mean, many people think holiness is some kind of Old Testament idea, but God said, be holy because I am holy. In other words, holiness matters to God. What you do in your private life and in your public life, they should match. How do we live as people of purity? How can we live in a way that's lovely and beautiful to other people, especially if they don't know Jesus? Like, man, I don't know what it is, but there's just something about those people. There's something that's so attractive about the way that they live. Let me ask this. What about the things that you eat and the things that you drink and the pills that you take and the things that you smoke or the things that you do to make you feel a different way? You see, in those moments, you can actually invite the Holy Spirit to help you surrender those things and to change the way you see those things and to work in your heart and mind to shape gratitude and awe and worship and purity and love. Some of you need a song or a verse that you can meditate on over and over again. In the recovery community, there's this beautiful prayer called the Serenity Prayer. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Listen, that's not just for people who struggle with addiction. That's for all of us. So Paul's saying there is a way to fight toxic thinking and anxiety with thoughtful meditation and grateful prayer. For me, I'll tell you, it's just taking a walk outside, especially when I'm feeling the pressure of trying to help my family or the pressure of my friendships or my neighbors or this church. Things I can't control, things I can't change, things that I need to speak into, and things that I need to be silent about. But as I'm able to walk, I'm able to pray, I'm able to worship in song, I'm able to get into God's word through an audio Bible. Verses like, God, even though my heart and flesh may fail, you are the strength of my heart. God, greater are you in us than he that is in the world. I am more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus, and no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Guys, we got to meditate on those things and remind ourselves that God is ever present in times of trouble. These are the ways to reframe all the things that want to pull you down into the chaos and the anxiety and the depression. And finally, as we begin to draw to a close, look at verse 9. Paul says, whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. There's that word again, practice. Put it into practice. You can practice these things and train yourself. Paul has modeled these things for us, which leads us to our last big idea here today, point number 5 there in your notes. We can fight apathy with action. See, it's not enough for Christians to just say, okay, you know what, in my home, I've learned to pray and sing worship songs and just block the whole world out so that I don't ever have to deal with any of their brokenness. That's not what Paul's saying at all. But Paul is stepping into the chaos. He's stepping into the brokenness and the darkness. He did it all the time. And as Christians, we can't just be concerned about ourselves. So how do we do that? How do we fight apathy with action? How do we pursue this holy ambition that Paul is talking about? How do we strain to fulfill the purpose and calling God has for us? If we're honest, far too often, our ideology leads our theology. So practically speaking, we need to start by being the kind of people who that everything that we believe, everything that we're deeply convicted about, comes from God's word first. Our allegiance is to the Bible first. So I want to challenge you to get into God's word every day and ask the Holy Spirit to give you convictions and deeply held principles that direct the way that you live, the way that you pray, and the way that you serve. Take some thoughtful, prayerful time to develop biblical convictions, because if we do, not only will we be good citizens of heaven, we'll also be good citizens here in our community. Amen? Amen. Let's conclude our time by fighting God's way in prayer together. Father God, you see us here today and you know everything about us, and yet you still love us. Lord, we're so very grateful. Lord, I pray for everybody within the sound of my voice who's struggling with forgiveness. They can't see through the fog that they're in. Walls have been built, things have been said and done, but I just pray, Father, that you would release them from the burden of holding somebody in a prison in their mind and in their heart. Free them, Lord, knowing that their name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And at the end of the day, that's what matters most. God, I pray for those who struggle with anxiety and depression and anger and fear and all the things that come with feelings that just seem to be beyond our control. Please, Lord, give them the grace to meditate on your word and to fight anxiety with gratitude. Do in their hearts and minds what they can't do on their own. Free them right now in Jesus' name. Father, I also pray for those of us who are just comfortable right now, living a comfortable life, because you've called us to be salt and light and to fight a spiritual battle and to give our lives in service and sacrifice to others. But Lord, we just haven't done so. I would pray that you would awaken us from our slumber right now. I pray that you would do this and so much more for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen. During our time together today, Paul gave us five very practical ways to fight. In your life, you're going to fight. But he just says, no matter what happens, you should fight God's way. He says to fight conflict with forgiveness. Fight extremism with moderation. Fight anxiety with grateful prayer. Fight toxic thinking with meditating on God's word. And fight apathy with action. Before we close in a final song, I want us to have a moment where we can fight. If you've had a difficult time forgiving somebody, you don't know how to let go, I want to give you an opportunity to repent today and to obey Jesus' command to forgive. I'm going to invite you to come forward, and I would love to pray with you. Or if you're battling anxiety or depression, maybe you feel overwhelmed or scared, maybe you even have a low grade level of apathy. Your Christian duty has been reduced and relegated to just coming to church, singing a few songs, going home, and then coming back next week. I mean, if that is your Christian life, then you need to know that God has called you to so much more than just an hour and a half on Sunday mornings. I would love to pray with you about that as well. Or maybe you want to start a relationship with God through his son, Jesus. The Bible says, repent and be baptized. Today is the day of salvation. So really, whatever need you may have, please come forward as we all stand and sing together right now.
Sins and griefs to bear.
Turn to him. He is good and he is faithful. It's been a great Sunday worshiping with you, church. We hope to see you next week. You have a great rest of your Sunday.
Thanks again for listening today. We'd love to hear from you. If you'd like more information about our church, or if you just want to share what God's been doing in your life, drop us a line. Give us a call. Again, may God bless you.